rise and face the processional cross. Merry Christmas. Our worship begins the way our lives in Christ begin in baptism. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The impossible is about to happen in a stable. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light.
Those who live in the land of darkness, on them the light shines.
This is the night when creation stood still and held its breath, for God was doing the most unbelievable, dangerous thing. On this holiest of nights, on this most silent night,
we come, our hopes and dreams joining those of Mary and Joseph.
On this night of carols and candlelight,
we come, our blessed songs joining with
the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. It is easy to be excited tonight, Father. For most of us, joy comes quite naturally tonight. Some of us, though, Lord, have our wounds reopened at Christmas. Some of us grieve those who are not here. Meet us where we are tonight and give us your pure and endless joy. In the name of Jesus, amen. Merry Christmas. Please greet those around you and introduce yourself to anyone you might not know. And thank you for being here.
While you are greeting, I would like to invite the children to come forward for the children's message. It's all right. Welcome. I'm glad you're here. It's Christmas Eve. Have you been waiting for this for a long time? Yeah, really long time. What's your favorite thing to do to get ready for Christmas? Or your favorite thing to do when Christmas finally gets here? You like to make cookies. Yeah, what's your favorite kind of cookie? Sugar cookies. Oh, those are great. You like to decorate them too? Yeah? Do you guys all have your favorite cookies? Yeah? Excellent, excellent. What else do you like to do when it's Christmas? Open presents, of course. Presents are fun to open. Yeah, is it fun to give presents to and see people's expressions? Absolutely, absolutely. Is it really fun to watch the Vikings win? Yeah, yeah, that's exciting too. That doesn't always happen on Christmas Eve or Christmas Day, but that's part of it too. Yeah, exciting things happen on Christmas. What else do you like to do at Christmas or getting ready for Christmas? Do you put up decorations? Do you help decorate the tree? Yeah? Do you get to see people that you don't see all the time? Maybe aunts and uncles or cousins or grandmas or grandpas? Maybe. Some of those you might see all the time. Some of them you might see on special holidays. You get to play games with your friends or your cousins, your playmates. Yeah, lots of fun things to do at Christmas. What else do we like to do at Christmas? Catch people under the mistletoe. Yeah. That sounds like fun. That sounds like fun. Yeah. What else do we love to do at Christmas? You're doing it right now. Go to church and worship Jesus. Exactly. That's the reason we do all these other fun things at Christmas. Yeah, and when we worship Jesus, that's awesome that you're here and that we're doing it here, but let's not leave the baby Jesus here. Don't forget to make the baby Jesus part of your Christmas celebrations at home, too, in the things that we do. When we are visiting with aunts and uncles and cousins and grandmas and grandpas that we don't see very often, maybe think about the wise men who traveled from a long way to see baby Jesus. And maybe when we get those favorite cookies that we get to eat and the favorite foods and the favorite snacks and the favorite appetizers that we only get at Christmas, maybe then remember that Jesus was born in the city of Bethlehem. And Bethlehem means house of bread. And in that house of bread was born someone very special who would say, "I am the bread of life." Yeah, we have special foods, we can remember Jesus who came, who was our bread of life. And he's promised that as followers of him, one day we'll get to be in heaven too and have a banquet feast that we can't even imagine as we feast here. When we open presents, what part of the Christmas story does that help us remind us of? The wise men brought gifts to Jesus, didn't they? Yeah, gifts to honor a king and a priest and a sacrifice. And we can remember that when we're opening presents. And maybe when we're so excited to be with the people around us, we could remember the excitement of the shepherds that came to see the baby Jesus, just as the angel had told them. Christmas is full of lots of fun stuff. But let's not just leave baby Jesus at church. Let's take him home with us and remember the reason we're doing all this celebrating. Now, as you leave, I have something to help you remember to take Jesus home with you. And for those of you that were a little shy about coming up, find me after church and I'll have one for you too. And it's a craft project that you can work on at home that will help you remember to celebrate the baby Jesus, not only when we come to church, but in all your Christmas celebrations. Will you say a prayer with me, please? Fold your hands. Dear Jesus, thank you for being the best gift at Christmas. Please help me remember to not only celebrate you at church, but to celebrate you in my celebrations at home, too. Happy birthday, Jesus. Amen. All right, you may come and grab one of these and take it with you.
Our Old Testament lesson tonight is from Isaiah, the 7th chapter. Again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz, "Ask the Lord your God for a sign, whether in the deepest depths or in the highest heights." But Ahaz said, "I will not ask. I will not put the Lord to the test." Then Isaiah said, "Hear now, you house of David. Is it not enough to try the patience of humans? Will you try the patience of my God also? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel." The word of the Lord.
Lord, to you.
Our epistle lesson is from 1 John, the 4th chapter. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. This is how we know that we live in him and he in us. He has given us of his Spirit, and we have seen and testify that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in them and they in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in them. The word of the Lord. I invite you to rise as you are able for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke chapter 2. Glory to you, O Lord. Now it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, every one unto his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill among men." And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, "Let us now go even into Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us." And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, as it was told unto them. This is the gospel of our Lord. You may be seated.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord Jesus. Amen. As I was pointed out during the children's message, there's lots of things that are important about Christmas and lots of things we do to celebrate the birth of Christ. You know, it probably wasn't until I became a pastor that I could honestly say that for me, worship was the most important part of Christmas. And it wasn't until my kids got older and started moving out that I realized just how important getting together as family is at Christmas. One of the things we do at Christmas, kids come home from college or from wherever they're living and get everybody in the same house, and it's wonderful and it's crowded. I imagine there's at least one of you tonight that's going to be sleeping on that fold-out couch that's got the metal bar going through it and you can't get any sleep at all, and somebody's probably on an air mattress on the floor. I know when we go to my in-laws' house, there's 17 of us in one three-bedroom, 130-year-old farmhouse with one real bathroom, and it gets crowded. And I remember a story my wife told of a Christmas blizzard where there were 30 of them in this three-bedroom farmhouse. And when we're all there, it's my future daughter-in-law that gets the crummy fold-out couch with the bar through the middle. And it's all the younger, really flexible people that get the floor in the basement. But that's what we do at Christmas, right? We make room. We just make room, whether it's at the table or whether it's in the bed for people to sleep, we make room. And I was thinking about that this Christmas season because it's exactly the opposite of what happened the first Christmas. There was no room at the inn. You know, Caesar Augustus had issued a decree that all the world was to be taxed, and everyone had to go to their ancestral hometown to be taxed. That means Joseph went to Bethlehem, to the city of David, to register for taxes. But that also meant that all of Joseph's aunts and uncles and brothers and sisters, if he had any, and cousins, all of them would be going to Bethlehem too. And there'd be lots of family there to take care of family. And yet there was no room at the inn. And the Lord of all glory had to be born in a stable and placed in a manger, which is a fancy word for an animal's feed box. How could that happen? You know, there's all sorts of family there. And yet there's Jesus and Mary and Jesus, either in a stable or a manger cave or a room where animals eat, because there's no room with the rest of the family. There's lots of theories have been proposed about why that might be. One I was intrigued by this year was that perhaps it was because of the scandal of Mary's pregnancy, that things were not good in Joseph's family, between the family and Mary. And so there was no one there to help them out. They were the outsider, the outcast, the oppressed. And I think about that. I think about the fact that Jesus had to be born in a manger because there was no room for him anywhere else, no one to take him in. And I think about those words that Jesus would say towards the very end of his life when he's talking about judgment. And Matthew writes, "I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. I was naked, and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me." Then they will answer, "Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?" Then he will answer them, "Truly I say to you, to the extent that you did not do it to the least of these, you didn't do it for me." I think about that in terms of the Christmas story. There was no one welcoming Jesus, no one making room for Jesus. And they were locking out the Lord of glory. They were locking out the very creator of the universe, the one who John said was with God in the beginning, was out, without him was not anything made that was made, and there's no room for him. The world could not contain him, and yet there's no room for him. And yet somehow, this story becomes glad tidings of great joy for all people. You know, that Christmas story didn't start with Mary and Joseph alone in a stable at Bethlehem. And it didn't start when the angel appeared to Mary and told her that she would give birth to the Son of God. Or even with the prophets, who for hundreds of years have been talking about the coming of the Messiah. The Christmas story began in the Garden of Eden, when God looked at the creation that he had so lovingly made and so had so unnecessarily become ruined by sin. And God made his plan right then. And his plan, the word we use in it, church, is incarnation. It means God took on skin. God took on diapers and potty training and acne and hormones. The one who created the whole world became dependent upon a human mother for survival. That was God's plan. God had to become vulnerable. God had to take on a human head so that it could be crowned with thorns. God had to take on human hands and human feet so he could be nailed to a cross on Good Friday. God had to become the ultimate outcast, the ultimate lost one, the ultimate oppressed one. That was God's bold and daring plan. And that's why we're here. And that's why one day we'll be in heaven. Because Jesus did all of this in our place, Jesus lived perfectly and died innocently because we couldn't and wouldn't, and it was what had to happen in order for those glad tidings of great joy for all people to truly be glad tidings of great joy. You know, the idea of God becoming human, of God becoming dependent, of God becoming vulnerable, it's a great story. And it's the story of every one of us. It's a story that means that God loves us in ways that we can't begin to comprehend, and he loves us just the way we are. Whether we're in a crowded house, whether we're the ones sleeping on the crummy fold-out couch or the air mattress on the floor, or whether we're the only one in the house tonight, the miracle of Christmas is that God is God in the flesh, God with us, Emmanuel. And we see that in a Mary and a Joseph and a Jesus for whom there is no room. They become the outcast, the lost, the least, the oppressed. And I think when we can begin to see Jesus in that way, then we can begin to see Jesus in other people like that, the least and the lost and the outcast and the oppressed. And we can begin to understand what the love of God truly is. It's for those for whom the world and perhaps even the church sometimes has no room. We gather tonight in this warm church, in the glow of the candles and the glow of the light of God's love. And we need to let this vision of a world turned upside down and right side up by a baby in a manger. We need to let that challenge us into seeing the need for Jesus in people all around us, and seeing the need for that commandment that Jesus gave at the end of his life: as I have loved you, love one another. That means serve, clothe, feed, house, visit. As I have loved you, love one another. This is how people will know you're my disciples, Jesus said, if you love one another. And that really brings this story to a place where we can truly call it glad tidings of great joy for all people. Amen and amen. Let's stand up now and confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, crucified also. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. We worship the Lord with our offerings, and during our offering, some of our musicians have planned a special musical offering for us.
Thank you.
Thank you to Carrie and Renata and all of our musicians for the great musical offering, for using your gifts to praise God. Thank you for that. Let's pray. Praise, honor, and glory to you, O Lord. With angels and archangels, we magnify your name. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among people with whom he is pleased. Lord Jesus, we adore your divine goodness. We praise you for sending salvation, bringing salvation to us, for including us in the fulfillment of your promises. We thank you, Lord, for the gift of family, and we pray your blessing upon our family gatherings this year. We pray that the peace on earth the angels promised would be part of our get-togethers. We pray that the glory to God in the highest, of which the angels sang, would be part of what we're doing as Christian families. We thank you, O Lord, for the musicians, the singers, the messengers who help us rejoice in your Son's birth. We pray that you bless the reception of your good news in all the hearts where it is heard. Bless the spread of this Christmas message throughout the world, and may these glad tidings of great joy bring hope to the discouraged and peace to the troubled. Father, we pray for all those who are going through this Christmas season with challenges, for people that are grieving, like Deb Santillo and her family at the death of Aunt Lila, and for all those who are sick or who are recuperating or facing surgery, and those we name silently before you now. Lord, bring your healing to these according to your will, and while they wait for healing, fill them with your good tidings of great joy. Fill them with the hope that belongs to all who worship Jesus. And now, Lord, may the peace of Christmas fill our nation and the nations of the world. This we ask in the name of our Savior, Jesus. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Come, thy will be done, earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As we prepare to celebrate our Lord's birth, and receive him as he still comes to us today, let us also remember the season Jesus was born, the reason Jesus was born. He has appeared once for all at the end of the ages to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. He's come to bring peace, yet not always in ways we can see in this world. He's come to bring peace, yet not always in ways we can see in ourselves, in our thoughts, words, and actions. He has come to bring peace, that is, forgiveness of sins and peace with our Father in heaven. We confess that we have sinned against God and against one another. We yearn for peace with God and reconciliation with one another, yet we cannot accomplish it ourselves. Forgive us, Lord, and restore our souls, that our lives reflect not our sin, but the joy. Hear the good news, people of God. The babe of Bethlehem becomes the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. The manger is exchanged for a cross where Jesus dies innocently and perfectly so that our sins are perfectly forgiven. It's my joy and privilege to stand in his stead and to speak the words he commands me to speak. All of your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, God's people say, let's reflect for a moment on what we're doing when we come to the Lord's Supper. You know, the virgin birth is a miracle. Jesus taking on flesh is a miracle. And Jesus coming to us in the Lord's Supper is a miracle. He says this is his body, this is his blood. We can't see that, we can't understand that. All we can do is by faith believe that in a way that we can't see or understand, Jesus is present in with and under the bread and wine with his body and blood to forgive our sins and to give us life and salvation. That's what we believe about the Lord's Supper. That's what you believe. You're invited and encouraged to join us. And we set apart this Holy Supper for the Lord's holy use with the Lord's holy words. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the New Testament, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. If you are taking communion in your pew, we invite you to take and eat the body of Christ. And take and drink the blood of Christ shed for you for the forgiveness of sins.
Thank you.
May this true body and blood of our Lord Jesus strengthen and preserve you in true faith to life everlasting. Serve the Lord in peace. Amen. Let's rise for the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. And God's people say,